Ever wondered how large networks are divided into smaller and more manageable pieces? Or how IT professionals ensure efficient use of IP addresses in massive organizations? You're in the right place. Welcome to Whiteboard Doodles, the channel where we simplify tech-related concepts using whiteboard animations. Today, we'll break down the concept of subnetting, showing you how networks are split into subnets to optimize performance and security. Let's dive in. First, let's take a look at what subnetting is. Subnetting is the process of dividing a larger network into smaller, more manageable subnetworks or subnets. By breaking down a network, subnetting helps organize and efficiently allocate IP addresses, preventing waste of IP resources. It enhances network performance by reducing traffic congestion and improves security by isolating different parts of a network. Subnetting also allows network administrators to better manage and control access within different areas of a network, making it easier to troubleshoot and maintain. Each subnet operates independently, yet remains part of the larger network, ensuring efficient communication between devices. Now let's briefly take a look at IP addresses and subnet masks. An IP address is a unique numerical label assigned to each device connected to a network, allowing it to communicate with other devices. It's essentially the digital address that helps identify and locate devices within a network or across the internet. IP addresses come in two versions, IPv4, which consists of four sets of numbers, and IPv6, which uses a longer format to accommodate the growing number of devices online. Subnet masks, on the other hand, are a crucial companion to IP addresses. They determine how the address is split between the network portion and the host portion. A subnet mask consists of a sequence of numbers, typically written in the same format as an IP address, that tells the device how much of the IP address belongs to the network and how much is reserved for the individual device. For more in-depth information on IP addresses, be sure to check out our separate video covering the topic in the video description. Expanding on IP addresses, let's take a look at IP address classes. IP address classes are a method of categorizing IP addresses based on their range and intended use, providing a structured approach to allocating addresses within a network. The primary classes are Class A, B, C, D, and E. Class A addresses are designed for very large networks, allowing for up to 16 million hosts, making them suitable for major organizations and ISPs. Class B addresses support medium-sized networks with up to 65,000 hosts, ideal for universities and larger businesses. Class C addresses are typically used for small networks, accommodating up to 254 hosts, making them common in smaller offices and home networks. Class D addresses are reserved for multicast groups, allowing a single packet to be sent to multiple hosts simultaneously, useful in streaming media and conferencing applications. Finally, Class E addresses are reserved for experimental purposes and research, often used in advanced networking protocols. Understanding these classes is crucial for efficient network design and management, allowing network administrators to allocate IP addresses according to the specific needs of their networks. The range between 126.0.0.0 and 128.0.0.0 includes IP addresses which are part of Class A but are primarily reserved for loopback addresses, allowing applications to communicate with the host without requiring an external network. The most commonly used address in this range is 127.0.0.1, often referred to as localhost. Now let's take a look at basic subnetting calculations. For subnetting, we need the original IP address and the subnet mask. Suppose we have the IP address 192.168.1.0 and the subnet mask 255.255.255.0. To begin, we convert the subnet mask into binary. If you're unfamiliar with this process, we recommend checking out our separate video on binary linked in the description. The subnet mask in binary reveals the division between the network and host portions. In this case, the subnet mask translates to 24 ones and 8 zeros. The number of zeros in the subnet mask determines the number of possible hosts. The general formula to calculate the number of possible addresses in a subnet is 2 to the power of n, where n is the number of bits allocated for the host portion. In this example, there are 8 zeros, so the number of possible addresses is 2 to the power of 8, which equals to 256. However, not all of these addresses can be assigned to devices. The first address in this range is reserved for the network ID, which identifies the subnet itself, and the last address is reserved for the broadcast address, used to send data to all devices in the subnet. This leaves us with 254 usable IP addresses. Additionally, it's important to note that the more zeros in the subnet mask, the more hosts can be supported within that subnet. Conversely, a subnet mask with more ones means fewer hosts but more subnets. The number of subnets can be calculated using the formula 2 to the power of m, where m is the number of bits borrowed from the host portion to create subnets. In our example, no bits were borrowed, so the network has only one subnet. If we were to borrow bits, it would reduce the number of hosts per subnet but increase the number of subnets, allowing for a more structured network layout. Now that we understand the basics of subnetting, let's dive into how to read and interpret it. Reading and interpreting subnetting requires identifying key elements like the network address, broadcast address, and the range of usable IP addresses. A common way to represent this is through CIDR or classless interdomain routing notation, which combines the IP address with a suffix that indicates the number of network bits in the subnet mask. For example, an IP address of 192.168.10.15/24 tells us that the first 24 bits belong to the network portion, leaving 8 bits for hosts, since there are a total of 32 bits in an IPv4 subnet mask. To determine the network address, you set all host bits to 0, giving you 192.168.10.0 in this case. The broadcast address is the address where all host bits are set to 1. In this example, it is 192.168.10.255. The range of usable IP addresses falls between these two values, starting from 192.168.10.1 to 192.168.10.254. CIDR notation helps quickly identify how the network is segmented, making it easier to organize and allocate IP addresses efficiently. Now let's explore some common subnetting scenarios that network administrators encounter. When working with subnetting, several situations arise that help optimize network performance and management. One prevalent situation is dividing a large corporate network into smaller subnets to enhance security and reduce congestion. For instance, a company might separate its administrative, engineering, and guest networks, ensuring that sensitive data remains protected while allowing for efficient traffic management. Another common scenario involves allocating subnets based on geographic locations, enabling remote offices to communicate effectively while maintaining separation from the main corporate network. Additionally, organizations often implement subnets to accommodate growth. As the number of devices increases, they can easily create new subnets without overhauling the entire network structure. Lastly, internet service providers frequently use subnetting to manage their IP address space effectively, distributing ranges to customers while ensuring optimal utilization and avoiding address wastage. These scenarios illustrate the versatility and necessity of subnetting in modern network management. As we dive deeper into subnetting, it's important to understand the differences between classful and classless subnetting. Earlier in the video, we covered the different IP address classes, A, B, C, D, and E, which are central to classful subnetting. In this system, IP addresses are divided into these fixed classes, each with a predefined subnet mask, limiting flexibility in allocating address spaces. This rigid structure often led to inefficient use of IP addresses, especially for smaller networks that didn't need the large number of addresses assigned by the class system. On the other hand, classless subnetting, known as CIDR, which we discussed in a previous chapter, allows for more flexibility by letting you choose any number of bits for the network portion of an IP address, rather than being confined to the fixed class ranges. This flexibility helps allocate IP address space more efficiently, minimizes waste, and improves network scalability by allowing organizations to create subnets that fit their specific needs. CIDR also enhances routing efficiency by reducing the size of routing tables, making it the preferred method in modern networks. When managing IP address allocation and subnetting, it's crucial to be aware of potential pitfalls and adhere to best practices to optimize network performance. One common mistake is neglecting to document subnet configurations, which can lead to confusion and inefficient management, especially in larger networks. It's essential to maintain clear records of assigned IP ranges, subnet masks, and the purpose of each subnet. Another pitfall is failing to consider future growth. Organizations should plan their subnetting with scalability in mind to accommodate potential expansions without readdressing the entire network. Adopting a hierarchical addressing scheme can enhance routing efficiency and simplify network management. Additionally, regularly reviewing and updating address assignments helps avoid conflicts and ensures optimal utilization of IP address space. By following these best practices, network administrators can minimize errors, enhance performance, and ensure their networks remain flexible and manageable. In conclusion, understanding subnetting is crucial for optimizing network performance and efficient IP address management. By grasping the fundamentals of subnetting calculations, interpreting CIDR notation, and recognizing the differences between classful and classless systems, network administrators can design networks that are both scalable and efficient. Additionally, adhering to best practices, such as thorough documentation, planning for future growth, and regular reviews, can significantly reduce errors and enhance network performance. With these principles in mind, organizations can ensure their networks remain robust and adaptable to changing needs. This concludes our exploration of the basics of subnetting. If you enjoyed it, consider subscribing to our channel and liking the video. Feel free to also check out our other videos on related topics. Thank you for watching.